Well, I always love playing music with John. John is easily one of the most inspiring musicians to play with. Music runs out of him like water down a mountain. And it's always there, and it's always interesting, and it's always really great fun to play against because he's not playing what I would play. Fancies, chase the costumes she
shall wear. His electric viola and violin, all of those sounds that go on and on and on, weren't used in popular music or rock music previous to that. John was really probably the flavor that made it so outstanding and such an inspiration to groups for decades after.
The Velvet Underground are one of those bands that have had an influence on almost every generation of group that's come beyond them. And John Cale, to a lesser degree than the Velvet Underground, because the Velvet Underground as a collective, I think, had that. But John Kelter has also, to anybody who's serious about music, you know, he features. Would awake me, different colors
made of tears. Did you ever expect that your son would become a famous pop star one day?
Well, no, I don't think I did this. It's quite a surprise. I won't say shock, but a surprise.
A pleasant surprise?
Oh, yes. Kiss the boot of shiny, shiny leather. Shiny leather in the dark.
Tongue the thongs, the belt that does await you. Strike, dear mistress, and cure his heart.
Wearing cover and grotin, what I have a mass America, I only got to see a lot on a bidiathan over there.
John Cale, basically a little kid in a small town in Wales, very rapidly sort of catapults himself through all these different colleges, whatever, institutions, into the absolute central beating heart of the New York Underground, which is the Lamont Young, the group around Lamont Young.
I got Lamont's number from John Cage, who I'd been in touch with at Goldsmiths. At that point, when I got to New York, Cage had already handed over the baton to Lamont as the leading figure in the avant-garde. And I'd heard that he had a group that he was playing with, and I took my viola down there and introduced myself.
And there was no doubt about John's musicianship. I mean, the first thing that starts coming through in the phone call is the empathy, you know, the sense that he really wanted to work with me and that he was very interested in new music. Then I find out he plays viola. He said, "Oh, I've stopped playing viola." And I said, "Never mind, bring it along."
I'd never been involved in work of that kind before, where you sustained a drone for an hour and a half, every day for a year and a half.
I think one of the things that John enjoyed and later found was very important to him in working in the Theatre of Eternal Music group was this kind of discipline.
I kind of went and worked with Lamont, and from there went and did the Eric Satie piece with Cage, which was kind of a 36-hour event.
John got a bit of notoriety from that because his photograph was in the paper.
Yeah, John Cale's photograph was in the paper.
That was one of the better reviewed events that took place.
Well, it was a nice
because
touch.
Because of Cage's prestige.
The names Cale and Cage. Mm-hmm. It was a very nice touch.
I'm sitting outside of 56 Ludlow Street, which is the building in which John Cale lived between 1964 and 1965 and basically formed the Velvet Underground. It was a very, very rough neighborhood. It's a big drug-dealing neighborhood at night. Landlord used to collect the money with a gun, even though it was only $30 a night, and he often actually had the gun out when he came to the door. They lived really a classic bohemian life you can sort of see in a comic book. I mean, they went out in the street in the wintertime and found wood and brought it back and made a fire. They lived off of one great big bowl of some kind of food. And people would throw things into it, I think, as the time went on. They literally had no money. Into this scene, in the very beginning of 65, just 3 months after John moved here, that Lou Reed showed up, who at the time was a 22-year-old songwriter working for a schlock record company out on Long Island called Pickwick Records.
He was very concerned that being paid $25 a week to write songs in the style of anybody they decided were fine at the time, that the songs he really wanted to record would never get recorded. And in a very heroic mode, I said, hell with them, let's go and do it anyway.
John, he was coming from a completely different culture and a completely different musical background. And meshing that with what was more or less straight ahead rock was a really interesting thing because it brought a whole other personality to it.
He was in a very fragile state because he'd just come out of shock therapy. And he was on medication and introduced me to the whole panoply of drugs that I otherwise would not have known about. Also, a certain element of the hustling life was shown to me.
Wrap your troubles in dreams, take 5. Oh, fuck. I won't even tell you what happened.
Shit.
Take 9.
Jesus.
10.
Oh, yeah.
Take 11.
When we got to work at Ludlow Street, when Lou had introduced Moe and Sterling into the combination, we spent a year really focusing on rehearsing. And every weekend we would get together and we would rehearse and rehearse and rehearse and rehearse. Because I'd come out of that ethic with Lamont, and it was the only way I knew of really breaking new ground.
My role was to keep the beat, which sounds kind of dumb, but especially at first, we did a lot of improvising, and we'd play something for a half hour. John and Lou would go off into space, and there needed to be something grounding the whole mess, which was basically Sterling and I. For a while, our joke was we knew how good we were by how many people we drove out. And we very often did drive lots of people out. But it really was so different from what was going on, and people didn't know what to expect, of course.
We played a tourist dive in the village, and I can't remember the name, the Cafe Bizarre. And there was nothing bizarre about it, it was just a dump. And almost no one came in, and if they heard us, they left. There was were some sailors there, I think. And we played Black Angel's Death Song, which is gets pretty atonal, put it that way. These guys went crazy. They said, you know, if you play another song like that, we'll beat the shit out of you. So we played it again, and chairs flying, and that was the end of it. We were fired. And from, but adopted by Warhol that week, as it turned out.
We're sponsoring a new band. It's called The Velvet Underground. And we're trying to, well, since I don't really believe in painting anymore, I thought it would be a nice way of combining, and we have this chance to combine music and art and films all together.
The factory was an ex-firehouse. I mean, it was really, really big, and it was all covered in silver foil because Billy Name had covered it with silver foil.
Always had opera on there. And there'd be a couple of people like Ondine and Rotten Rita, and they would be singing the arias along with Maria Callas or whatever. And Andy would be on the phone. Gerard and a midget and some of the other people would be making the silkscreens. And there was, it was always a lot of work going on.
Everybody was doing something, if only supplying drugs. I mean, that is, yeah, that's your job.
If we went up there around 2 o'clock in the afternoon, by around 4 o'clock, people would start drifting by, and you'd have Bob Dylan or Peter Fonda or any number of film stars.
We were in and out because we didn't have any other place to be.
It took a lot of convincing from Paul, convincing Andy, to Andy urging Lou that it would work better if we did have a beautiful girl in it. But it was so magic that it did happen with the reluctance of Lou and John and everybody, because when she did start singing with him, and that first album is so macabre, I mean, she is so severely interesting.
When she first showed on the stage, she was tall, very blonde, and very Teutonic, and immaculate. And slowly over the years, we learned that she was deaf in 1 year, but that didn't really matter. She had the persona on stage, and everybody was riveted by it. And Lou wrote us some very beautiful songs.
I was just, you know, this poor little rock and roller. You know, like, he was this goddess. It was incredible. And we figured, wow, what are we going to do with her? So we said she could play tambourine or something. The thing she does to please, she's just a little tease. When we finally were signed to a record company, really on the basis of Andy, I mean, because Andy said he'd do the cover, I don't know if we would have gotten a contract if he hadn't said he'd do the cover, or if Nico wasn't so beautiful. I mean, who knows? For the longest time, people thought Andy Warhol was the guitar player.
Oh, this is so glamorous.
What Andy did was provide a location for us, an intellectual location, so that whatever we wanted to do, everybody around us was of the same frame of mind and had the same intention. And although it was chaos that we were after, this was a very beautiful chaos that we were in.
The idea of putting us to perform at the hotel for the psychiatrist was the perfect little stroke.
was absolutely incredible. I don't know what we were doing there. Some of the rest of our people descended on these psychiatrists and started asking them the most embarrassing questions they could conceive of. It was absolutely hilarious. It was just fantastic.
The comment that came back from the psychiatrist was, you suggest that these guys have a long rest. They're disturbed individuals and need a long rest.
Everybody used fuel. I used methamphetamine most of the time. John and Lou both got more into the heavier musician type stuff, like heroin. You can't say it would have been different if they weren't taking drugs, because that's what the world was then. You know, the world would be different if it wasn't that nobody was taking drugs, not just the Velvet Underground.
Don't you know you'll stain the carpet? And by the way, it's got a dollar. Oh no, man, I haven't got the time. Too busy sucking on the ding dong. Busy sucking on my ding dong. Oh, she just does that.
It wasn't until after the first album came out, and then we were working on the second album, that we had all known each other long enough, the sound had gelled, the Velvet Underground knew what its sound was, that personal relations started to take their place and sometimes get in the way, you know, because Lou Reed and John Cale are both very strong controllers.
If he didn't like you and therefore became afraid of you, it was important for him to sort of remove you before you removed him. I mean, there was always that was the competitive nature, was who would get to who first.
Lou made an ultimatum that either he or John would have to go. And Sterling, he called Sterling and I, and we met him at a coffee shop or something. And he told us this, you know, he just couldn't work with John anymore, and we could either stay with him or go with John, whatever. So basically, John was kicked out.
Stabbed in the back. I can't deal with you, so I'll get somebody else to deal with you. Lou couldn't tell me to my face, so he sent Sterling over.
That's really personal. And it's probably something I wouldn't talk about.
I knew it would not be, the music wouldn't be the same without any one of us. But without John, certainly, there would be a big difference in the music. And I like John, you know, I like him. And it was a lousy way to end that foursome. An unhappy ending is unhappy.
Picked up.
Oh, ho ricordato che avevo il piano e invece avevo il piano per l'organo di Gius Carnant. Non ho ni vicino, ho bajato il vicino, ho bajato il piso.
A place called Garnant. That's also called Cwm Aman because it's in the Aman Valley. I spoke Welsh. I learned English in school. This spot here is the landfill for Gellicaidrim Colliery, where my father worked until they closed it down. And they filled in the pit of the mine. There's now this artificial hill here. This would be very quiet on a Sunday. You could hear the people with Numa walk up the street. I would be able to tell when somebody was going by the house because I could hear the rasping.
Most people took it that it was like night after day. You went to the mines and it was taken for granted. All my friends and all my generation, they were all involved in that sort of, there was nothing else.
My mother was a school teacher. She taught in the little school at the back of the house. It made a very strong point on my head that I don't want to go down the mines. And there was a lot of emphasis on education.
She said the only time he'd come and play with us would be on a Saturday morning. And that he'd be told that when he came over, he'd have to be home by 1 o'clock. And if he, you know, when it came up to that sort of witching time, if he wasn't home, he'd get in an ill state because his mother could see our house from where she lived. And occasionally she'd come and look for him, and if he could see her coming across the footpath, he'd freeze. And my mother, I don't know, I can't remember this, but my mother said once he fainted and passed out in the lawn when he saw his mother. He was 9 or 10 years old. He was, you know, terrified of her.
Hello, Dick. How are you now? Well, my mother really put my nose to the grindstone when I was about 7 and started me on a series of piano lessons. By the time I was 10, I was doing like 4 exams a year. And I would spend all my evenings practicing.
John's mother would probably have liked him to be a doctor or a lawyer, or even probably more important, not financially, but a preacher in the chapel.
This is the church that I went to for Sunday services and where I started playing the organ and became interested in liturgical composition and high church organ and high church services. But I went to Ammanford for lessons. There's a larger church there, larger instrument. In the grammar school, they were provided with a whole roster of instruments. And when I first went to join the orchestra, they had nothing. And then about a year later, they found a viola. Well, a viola is the saddest of all instruments, and you can't really, no matter how fast you play it or how good you are, you can't really get away from the character of melancholy in it.
Can't wait to get there. Once we get there, you know, it's much more beautiful. They have sheep there instead of cows, right? It's all cows here. Sheep when you get to Wales. sex thing.
The beauty of the place is something that you can't get away from. And there are certain things that, certain patterns of behavior you pick up when you're young that never go, never leave you. And moments of tranquility that you get when you're young that are always the most valuable for some reason. And that nostalgia, that sense of nostalgia is really, is always with you because it's a way of inuring yourself against the passage of time.
I carry out Fadlon for Pale Marsai Dyer Iamiris in Denning Alon Aldo.
An uncle who was a violinist, he would take me down to Llandeilo on weekends and visit the slaughterhouse and just take me inside and let me see the business that was being done there. And it was gory enough and it was fascinating to watch. I think it was rite of passage to show what was going on in the world.
Envied and we bodies in and bodlong.
Decent church going women with their mean, pinched, bitter, evil faces.
This is Radio Moscow.
Are there any questions about that?
31.
My fellow Americans, I'm happy to have this opportunity.
Shall inherit the earth.
I lived a life of the imagination on the radio waves, listening to Radio Moscow, Voice of America, Radio Luxembourg, and I was much more interested in what was going on the other side of the world than next door. So I became a New York creature here, primarily, because I knew that when I went to sleep that somewhere there was something really fascinating going on and I was missing out on it.
Any questions about that?
Right, here we are in front of John Cale's house, and I'm very excited about what we're going to find out while we're here in Ghana. And I think that the things I'm most interested in finding out are where the church is that he played the organ in, and where he had sex with the vicar's daughter.
I can't remember now exactly.
No, but it's very interesting to me to know that you were sitting next to him in the choir.
I was always. We were always sitting together and we were singing.
Yeah, yes. I didn't know that. That's wonderful to know. I'm going to ask him about that.
Yes.
Do you ever remember him coming back from the States to visit?
I got a faint memory of him coming back.
I heard that he'd been involved with some which I wasn't very much interested in pop music, but I heard that he was involved with some called Lou Reed, who I didn't know anything about. And a fellow called Andy Warhol, who used to do all sorts of weird art things and make a lot of money out of it. And was he something, some involvement there, somehow, wasn't there, with Andy Warhol?
Across from behind my window screen.
After leaving the Velvet Underground, the first project I got involved with was arranging Nico's second album, Marble Index. Now, she'd come up with these songs on the harmonium that were very pretty and really not characteristic of what you imagine somebody who was a heroin user to come up with, but, you know, really very, very melodic and tuneful songs. there was this little girl inside her that would always pop up from time to time. And that was kind of charming. So in the studio, she would lose sight of exactly what the recording process involved. At the end of the day, she would sort of burst into tears, and you'd wonder what on earth had you done to warrant this. And she would say, "No, no, no, it's just beautiful." It was a very personal relationship.
Fly a hermit stumbled solver, the cloudy borderline. Close and warnings close to mine, close to the frozen borderline. Close and warnings close to mine, close to the frozen borderline, close to the frozen borderline, close to the frozen borderline.
It was the first time I'd written a 90-minute ballet. There's a lot of pieces that I'm just scoring at the moment, and that's the most interesting part of it. What I've done so far is sketched onto the computer most of the musical ideas, and there are structures there. Right, so this is the choir. So where is the piano part, therefore? One and two and three and four. This is the first day of rehearsing the musicians, and the first time they've seen the score, and they've done pretty well. I wanted to make it all for violas, you know, it's for a small group that stays on the stage with the dancers. There are no conversations about the ballet. I mean, I don't know anything about the choreography at all, and I really have to trust in Ed that what I've done and what the length of everything is and the context in which it's in is right.
He tells me a lot about Nico just by giving me his music with his thoughts. The music shows that his feelings towards Nico are very warm, basically, and very intense, and it comes straight from his heart.
It's probably nostalgic, really evoking, apart from just her personality, but evoking that period that she was in the 60s and what she stood for. Danny Fields was working for Elektra Records in New York, and I get a call from him saying, "Jack Holzman, president, wants me to take you to Michigan to this concert to see this band. He thinks that you like this band and it's right up your alley."
That was when I got my chance to produce.
And I lay right down in my favorite place.
Three of them, and he would threaten an audience for a minute and sort of embrace them the next. It's great. They were really kind of magical.
And the music sounded not a little like what I enjoyed about the Velvets. The question was, could you put this onto a record? Nobody knew whether the band actually could sit still long enough to make the record as well as they performed it live on stage. But they did. They walked in and were very professional about it and did everything exactly the way recording should be done. And when it came to listening to the words were fine. They were just, I Wanna Be Your Dog was excellent. You have to provide them with something that really rewards them for what they are at the moment and provide some kind of outlet for them for the future.
His talents as a producer, which are exactly the talents that he brought to the Velvet Underground, really, that ability to take someone's fairly spare material and either orchestrate it or simply construct it in some way, interpret it, bring it out in the right way, find the person's voice, was so good, so powerful, and in the case of Patti Smith, certainly, so successful, that he got more attention than his own work.
The conversation, as I recall it, was I could not make sense whether I was being asked out on a date or whether I was being asked to really perform a job. And it was very funny and direct and straight to the heart about us. I mean, the lyrics were superior. And there was something about her persona and her ability with language that was really visceral and very warm. And you never really knew where it was going to fly off to. But it was miraculous in its flight. I still will hold.